When we think about drug dealers, we usually either think about shady guys in dark alleys or billionaire narco kingpins. But beyond those media cliches, we almost never stop to think about who these people actually are and why they choose to sell drugs in the first place. In this episode, we're getting inside the mind of a drug dealer.
I'm J.S. Raffaele. I've spent years writing about drugs, why people use them, and why our governments chose to declare war on them. Advice, we make a lot of films about drugs, but in this show, I get to dig a bit deeper. I get to talk to fellow expert drug nerds about their research into the crazy world of mind-altering substances.
Julia Buxton is a professor at the University of Manchester who spent years investigating international drug supply and how it intersects with issues of equality, race, and gender.
Julia, welcome to News on Drugs.
Thank you for having me.
So when we talk about drug dealers, most people would think they are either purely evil or just in it for the money. But your research indicates that actually we really need to rethink these assumptions, right?
Well, it is partly for the money, but it really depends on who's doing the selling, what drug it is, and the factors that lead people into dealing and selling drugs in the first place, which are very complex, and we have no single kind of model of a person who sells drugs. I think the other aspect here as well is it's not always necessarily for money. A lot of the time people are dealing drugs also as a kind of form of security. We've got a real record at the moment of people joining friendship groups and kind of social clubs and dealer groups, and it's in order to reduce the risk. So dealing can be a factor of money and motivated for monetary gain, but also it's a kind of security.
So let's start at the street level. How do organized crime groups go about recruiting drug dealers?
Well, again, depends on the country, depends on the drug. Huge amount of attention at the moment around this issue of county lines. So county lines is seen to be this process. It's this use of young people to come out of major city centres, travelling across borders, as it were, kind of regional borders in the UK, in order to transport drugs into rural areas, seaside communities, you know, outside of city centres. This has been the big focus for the Conservative government, dealing with what's seen as being child exploitation. And they're classifying this and kind of pursuing this through, you know, the concept of human slavery. And so the whole emphasis here is that it's based on coercion. So coercion of young people into these kinds of activities. Why young people? Because usually they're in communities where they're vulnerable to that type of recruitment. Young people are disposable. WhatsApp and digital technologies makes it very, very easy for, you know, younger people to come into this kind of trafficking activity and to communicate. They operate largely below the radar, and they're very, very easily replaceable. But also we're seeing cases now where, you know, young people are coming into this because they're seeing it as a way of supplementing household incomes. We're coming out of a period of austerity. People are really, really hard-pressed financially, and this is a way, unfortunately, of people adding to the money that's coming into the home.
As I understand it, this sort of emerged off the back of like quite successful police operations, and the gangs and organized crime groups would sort of start using kids as like a buffer between them and the police.
Mm-hmm. But you see, that's exactly the point, isn't it? This has emerged from police operations. This is the whole challenge that we have here, and this has been the record of the last 30, 40, 50 years since criminalisation in the 1961 UN Single Convention. And what we see is this enforcement activity. Again, this has been the work that I've been doing, looking at the situation in Afghanistan there, is that when you have these enforcement activities, they don't shrink the drug market. They have two effects. Firstly, they create violence. And why do they create violence? Because when you take down a crime group or when you have a major seizure of drugs, you leave a vacuum. And you have then competing groups that are challenging each other to control that vacuum. The second problem when you have this kind of enforcement activity is that it has the effect of dissipating the drug trade. County lines, in my view, is very much a product of successful law enforcement, as you've said, in some of these kind of major urban areas, but with the net effect of simply dissipating the drug traffic out into new markets.
And how have you seen this similar dynamics of child exploitation in your work in, say, like South America?
The most significant case, which is frequently referred to here, is probably Brazil, where you've had these gangs, the First Capital Command, the Red Command, which basically control the favelas, they control communities, they control societies, many of these kind of major urban centers of Sao Paulo and Rio. And they have the ability and the influence and the capacity to pressure young people to come into drug trafficking. And that can start at a very young age, 10, 11, 12 years old. And the drug trade is another manifestation of focusing on the most disposable elements of society in order to carry out highly lucrative activities. And ultimately what happens is that, you know, young people become institutionalized into these gang organizations, into these structures, because these organizations give them, as we said before, resilience, networks, stability, and income. And it's very, very difficult to get out of those networks. And in particular, where law enforcement and policing are not seen as being somebody that you can turn to support or turn to for help.
So is that like if you're like a 14-year-old kid on the streets of like Juarez or Chicago or Birmingham, you would be attracted to joining one of these gangs or like working for them as a drug carrier, almost for like self-protection, for security?
Yep, that's a really good way of seeing it. There's been a lot of focus on, you know, knives and on guns and on these kinds of contemporary manifestations of youth violence. But the reality is, yes, they are there as a form of protection, but ultimately it's not protection because it also increases massively your vulnerability, doesn't it, to that kind of gang-related violence. But I think the key thing here is to really focus on the types of challenges that young people face. Particularly the UK is a really, really good example here. The kind of cuts that we've seen over the last 10 years, you know, £1 billion cut from child and family services does have an impact. These kinds of impacts are massive. So we've lost that kind of social cohesion that gives young people, you know, identity, gives them this kind of self-belief, this ambition, and it completely skews it. There's that total vulnerability, which I think austerity bears a huge responsibility for. So if young people are looking to gangs for that kind of protection and security, then I think that's a tremendous failing of the state.
So that same 14-year-old kid, if he didn't think that he had an opportunity to get a job or there was no like economic advancement available to him in the legitimate economy, he'd go, well, I'll become a drug runner then.
Drug running does become an avenue. It becomes an opportunity in a world that seems to be full of dead ends and cul-de-sacs and very limited other opportunities. So I think we have to look at the coercion and the concerns around coercion. But at the same time, what we don't want to do is create a narrative that all young people, you know, are essentially drug running. These are the kind of stereotypes that are being built, aren't they? Because ultimately, the way that we are responding to this is criminalizing young people. It's not addressing the social context of their involvement in this kind of criminal activity.
I guess it kind of creates like a gray area, right, between like perpetrator and victim, right? Because like some kid can be coerced into becoming a drug carrier, then he rises through the ranks and ends up recruiting other kids. So he's like been exploited, but then exploits others.
If somebody's recruited into these kind of activities at age 13 or 40, and by 20, 21, they're recruiting other, well, the new generation of young children into it, that to me is a policy failure. Nothing has broken that up. So these cycles continue. So yes, we do have these crossovers, but that's also because we have this parallel informal economy, which is allowed to subsist and embed and becomes a viable option for people.
So what you have is the illicit drug market creating these very rich, powerful gangs who then step into the role that the state doesn't fulfill in these communities.
Absolutely, absolutely. And in many respects, these organizations play a kind of Robin Hood role, which, you know, is not to kind of romanticize or to glamorize. It's just the reality of life.
I mean, when we talk about getting inside the mind of a drug dealer in that case, right, from what you just said, we're talking about getting in the mind of very young people.
It can be, of course it can be, but not all of the drug dealing problems are just linked to, you know, these issues of youth alienation, austerity, underinvestment in youth services. This is a national problem, it's an international problem. I think that drug trafficking, drug supply activities are seen to be low risk. It's a complete myth. It comes with, you know, high levels of risk, high levels of violence, high levels of coercion. And it depends on what the drug is. So if we're talking about something which is, you know, kind of low volume, but high value,
like cocaine,
then obviously that's going to be quite a lucrative activity to be involved in, on the assumption that as the person who is involved in that supply activity, you're actually receiving quite a substantial amount of money as payment. And that's not always the case.
How does it work?
Well, because young people, for example, if you're carrying cocaine, you know, across county lines into different parts of the country, you're not yourself obviously going to be receiving a substantial payment relative to the value of that drug that's being trafficked. The money, as we know, is made at the top end.
So if you're that kid doing county lines or selling on the streets of Chicago or Juarez, right, you're passing thousands and thousands of dollars or pounds up the chain to your boss, and you're actually receiving what, like a few hundred bucks?
Yeah, but then the challenge is that ultimately those few hundred bucks do come with the provision of security. They come with that kind of prestige that might be attached to that kind of informal activity. And a couple of hundred pounds is actually more than you'd probably be getting if you're working in a fast food joint.
Okay, so aside from making money, I guess the main thing that most dealers think about is how to avoid the cops. What's the role of law enforcement in all this?
The role of law enforcement, I would argue, is actually as a driver, a continued dynamic within these illicit drug markets. I would argue very strongly that the challenge of incarceration, the challenge of putting people into prison, is that prisons essentially are graduate schools for becoming involved in illicit activities and criminal activities generally, but drug-related activities and drug dealing and drug trafficking specifically. So what we've seen with the emergence of some of the most sophisticated crime gangs globally, the First Capital Command in Brazil is the perfect example of this, is organizations that have grown out of prison settings to become really serious players, political players, in terms of power and illicit economies in their home country environments. Law enforcement in other country contexts, we can look at somewhere like Mexico. Mexico's drug trade problem really emerged from the complicity of policing. And that's not just a Mexico problem, this is also seen as being, you know, a wider global problem, is that the resources that drug trade activities bring in, they make it very, very easy to pay off police officers, to pay off port officials. I was at the Scottish Drugs Forum recently, which was really quite fascinating, because I think Scotland, because of its very, very high drug deaths, is trying to take a very different approach here. And law enforcement really trying to bring them in, you know, as a role in terms of addressing things like overdoses. So the Scottish police are now carrying naloxone in order that, you know, when they attend to overdoses, they can reverse these overdose situations. And so that's more of a partnership.
When you said prison is a graduate school for criminals, that's that 14-year-old kid, he's now 17, he ends up in prison, and he ends up in prison with really hardened veteran criminals, and he learns the ropes there.
It actually begins far earlier, and that's the problem. It's also increasingly, you know, youth detention centres, it's youth custody, so we're criminalising people at a young age. If you have this early exposure to the kind of criminal justice processes, is that you kind of develop this disdain towards policing. You know, you see policing as the enemy. You don't see them as somebody, you know, as a partnership within your communities. And Pablo Escobar was initially involved in, you know, low-level cannabis trafficking activities, and that was where his first encounter with law enforcement in Colombia, in Medellin, was because of cannabis. So what you're doing is you're kind of basically putting people on a fast track, I would argue, to wider drug trafficking networks.
So the idea of cannabis as a gateway drug, chemically we know is nonsense, but it could be a gateway drug when you're arrested for it.
Absolutely, I think that's a really clever point. I mean, cannabis, you know, the idea of cannabis as a gateway drug, we now know tobacco is more like the gateway drug than cannabis. What we did in the kind of 1990s is that we stopped, the customs and borders stopped drugs, you know, cannabis coming in from Morocco and Afghanistan. That had very low THC content, 2-3%. And we stopped that coming in, and that was seen as being, you know, a real victory in the war on drugs in the UK in the 1990s. What was the impact of that? Well, people began domestic manufacture within the UK And they were using, you know, hydroponic growing technologies, genetically modified cannabis seeds. And the result of this was to create, you know, a drug market here, which is dominated by this very, very high potency, high THC, skunk type cannabis.
And when we look at our like cliches and stereotypes about drug dealers, about what the drug dealer is, those stereotypes are not applied equally to different populations.
What we know historically is that overwhelmingly, the focus of policing has traditionally been on, unfortunately, minority and ethnic communities. And so what that has enabled is this kind of over-policing of communities that are predominantly black or predominantly Asian. You know, we saw that in Birmingham, we saw that in London, we've seen that in Manchester in the 1990s, the 1980s, you know, the whole idea of the Yardie. It's back to this idea that the dealer is somebody who's evil, somebody who's scary, and is an external threat that comes into your community or comes into your country. And this goes right back, you know, 100 years. It was the Chinese opium dealers. It was the Mexican marijuana smugglers.
So we also tend to think of drug dealers as men. But there are many women involved in this trade as well. How does the gender roles play out?
Historically, we have completely neglected the role of women in drug use and in drug supply. It's overwhelmingly been focused on men. It's been overwhelmingly focused on black and ethnic minority men. What we've seen over the last 10 years is that even though women are very, you know, very, very small number of the overall global prison population, is that overwhelmingly women are now being incarcerated on the basis of drug-related offences. 80% of the women in the prisons of Thailand are there on drug-related charges. I think in the Philippines it's around 60%, Mexico it's around 70%. This disproportionality, so it's really driving a kind of increase in the global prison population, but particularly amongst women. We've got 19,000 children under the age of 3 who are currently in prisons with women who are serving for drug-related offences. Austerity meant that more women were kind of being brought into the informal economy, the rise in the number of single female heads of household.
Literally mums and grandmothers selling drugs in order to send their kids to school.
It is essentially, yeah. The argument that women's involvement in the drug trade is driven by financial necessity is far stronger than it is for men. I think men become involved in the drug trade for a whole variety of reasons, you know, masculinities, identities, gangs. But where we are seeing the increase in the number of women who are involved in supply activities, this does seem to be economic hardship, which is a key driver.
And now to go to like the very top of the market, right? One thing I've never understood is why people like El Chapo Guzman, right? He's worth $1 billion. Why doesn't he just walk away and sit on his $1 billion? Why does he stay in the game and end up in maximum security prison in the States?
If you try and retire as a high-level drug dealer, then ultimately you do risk the fact that, you know, the political situation could change, you might be extradited, there's a threat of reprisals, there's a threat of arrest. So ultimately maintaining your profile in that trade enables you to kind of maintain those networks of security and protection around you that you've built up and which enabled you to become that high-level dealer in the first place. We see, you know, when Dubai at the moment, you know, kind of what's going on in some of these Gulf countries in terms of these emerging now as the new Costa del Crime, as it's being called. High-level actors seem to be moving there because there is a reduced risk of extradition. And this is the key thing, I think, that keeps so many people in the trade who, you know, arguably could retire, as it were, is that risk that they will face a criminal justice system at some point. As long as you're still in the trade, you're still able to kind of operate those kind of networks of threat and reprisal if you do yourself face law enforcement.
So how's drug dealing changing?
One of the things which is really important in changing the nature of dealing is dark nets. So we're seeing the, you know, the real strengthening of cyber-based drug transactions. And this is something which is very much limited to the global north countries, to Europe and North America. But what was fascinating during COVID is the number of people who turned to dark nets in order to purchase drugs. Sellers such as Canazone just saw this like boom in the number of people. People who'd never been on dark nets before were now buying their drugs online. And what's fascinating about these online drug purchases is that it's changing the skills and qualifications of being a drug dealer. Being a drug dealer on darknet markets doesn't require the use of violence. It doesn't, you know, to enforce contracts, to ensure debts are paid. A lot of the time, it requires things like, you know, really good marketing skills. The darknet is an eBay for drugs, as we know. It's kind of the skills you see in the formal economy is being applied on darknet drug markets. And darknet drug markets, even though they're only a small proportion of overall global markets, I think these are a very, very important form of drug supply going forward. And I think COVID and lockdown has completely transformed the importance of cyber markets.